Thank you everyone for joining us at Bank Exams today. I hope through this video you got a brief idea and introduction about Negotiable Instruments and Negotiable Instruments Act. In case you have any doubt or query regarding this, you may contact us at given number or you can visit our website. We are happy to announce that there is entire course developed by Bank Exams Today to help students who want to appear for IBPS SO Law Officer exams. You can contact us for more information and how to prepare for this exam. While enrolling for this course, kindly use the given coupon code to avail the benefits. Thank you. Hello everyone, this is CS Payal Tanchak and I welcome you all on behalf of Bank Exams Today. Our topic of discussion is Negotiable Instruments Act. Negotiable Instruments Act was enacted in the year 1881. It was the 26th Act of the 1881 year. It was enacted on 9th December 1881, but it was commenced from 1st day of March 1882. That means the date from which it became effective. Now let's read the layout of the Act. Layout of the Act is nothing but the structure of the Act or a drafting format of the Act. In India, almost all acts are formed in a similar format. So let's read it. Short title of the Act. It is nothing but the name of the Act. In our case, it is Negotiable Instrument Act 1881. Long title of the Act. It is nothing but the brief introduction of the Act. That is, in our case, in exact words, long title of the Act is an Act to define and amend the law relating to promissory notes, bills of exchange and checks. Third is preamble. Now many school theory of schools in law says that the preamble is not part of the Act itself. But it is very important to understand the preamble. Why? In many situations it happens that while interpreting certain provisions, there is a conflict of opinion. Two different opinions. So there are more interpretation of the same provision of the Act. In that case, which direction is the right direction and which direction, you know, perfectly interprets the provision with the same object for which it was actually enacted and included in the Act. You know, that direction, that, you know, checkpoint of that direction is given in the preamble. The very purpose of the Act is given in the preamble. It is very important to know the preamble of the Act. In our case, in exact wordings, the preamble of a negotiable instrument is, whereas it is expedient to define and amend the law relating to promissory notes, bills of exchange and checks, it is hereby enacted as follows. So this is the preamble. Now, applicability of Negotiable Act, it extends to whole of India, but nothing of this Act affects Section 21 of the Indian Paper Currency Act 1871. Whatever is written in Section 21 and whatever is regulated by Section 81 of the Paper Currency Act, this Act will not overwrite or overrule that section. Okay, or this section is also not applicable to any local usage relating to any instrument in an oriental language to certain extent. If that particular local instrument forms any legal relationship between two parties, then to certain extent this Act will become applicable to that local instrument also. Now, this is the chapter and section divisions of this Act. There are various chapters and sections to this Act, and this slide is very important for us for a reference purpose when we study this Act. Now, let's first discuss classification of negotiable instruments. How many variety of a classes negotiable instrument is recognized as per Negotiable Instrument Act? The very first classification of negotiable instrument is bearer instrument. The very known example of this instrument is bearer instrument is bearer check. Whoever is having the possession of a bearer check can get the payment. As simple as that. Bearer instrument is nothing but holder of the instrument can get or obtain the payment of the instrument. That is a bearer instrument. Inland instruments. Now, Section 11 recognizes and defines the inland instruments. What is inland instrument? A promissory note, bill of exchange, or a check drawn or made payable in India. Now, instrument which is made and payable in India are known as inland instrument as per Section 11. Okay, and also it needs to be drawn upon a person who is resident in India. Okay, such instruments are called inland instruments. So there is two criteria. Number one, drawn and made payable in India. And number two, drawn in India upon some person who is resident of India. Even if that person for a time being is not present in India, but he is in foreign country and the amount is paid in a foreign country. However, that person is resident Indian. Okay. In that case, also that instrument will be considered as inland instrument under Section 11. Now, foreign instruments. Foreign instruments are recognized and defined under Section 12. Any such instrument which is not inland instruments are considered as a foreign instrument. Very simple to understand. But let's decode this in a technical manner and in a legal terms. Foreign instruments are instruments which are drawn and payable outside India. Okay. Second, drawn in India upon some person who is not resident of India. And the payment is to be made outside India, that is in a foreign country. Okay, such instruments are known as foreign instruments. Ambiguous instrument. Section 17 deals with ambiguous instrument. The very word, you know, gives us the meaning of the instrument. Ambiguous means there is no clarity. In this, what we mean by not having clarity about the instrument, that means there are different type of a negotiable instrument, but particularly this classified instrument type is such that it has feature of a more than one negotiable instrument. Okay, and it is a valid to be considered as a both kind of an instrument. In such case, holder of the instrument has a choice to decide that how that person wants to treat this instrument as. For example, whether that person wants to consider that instrument as a promissory note or they want to treat it as a bill of exchange. They have the right to decide. But once they decide about how they want to go about this transaction and negotiable instrument, they cannot change that decision afterwards. Once it is decided, that instrument gets the identity and that instrument is no more considered as ambiguous instrument. Okay, so this was as per Section 17. Another example is demand instruments. It is governed under Section 19. Promissory note or a bill of exchange in which no time limit is specified for a payment. Okay, whenever the instrument is presented for a payment, the party who is supposed to make a payment needs to make a payment because it is a demand instrument. Similarly, in a case of a check. Okay, checks are payable on demand. Coated stamped instruments. Now, here, this kind of instrument are fully, completely valid because proper stamp duty is paid on such instrument, but they are incomplete as far as information is concerned. That means they are filling the blanks in the instrument. Incomplete information on face of the instrument. Certain information is missing in that instrument, but stamp duty is properly paid. In such case, holder of the instrument can put the details and fill the blank. Okay, to complete that instrument. But there is one condition. That is, they can only make certain arrangements which corresponds to the stamp duty paid. For example, for 1000 rupees valued instrument, 100 rupees stamp duty is required to pay. Now, receive incoated stamped instrument, that is incomplete information instrument. In that case, you can alter that instrument in such a way that the instrument value should not exceed rupees 1000. Why? Because the corresponding stamp duty paid on that instrument is rupees 100. Okay. That is our inchoated stamped instrument. Now, let's discuss what is negotiable instrument. Section 13 deals with negotiable instrument. Section 13 defines what is negotiable instrument. There are three types of negotiable instrument recognized under Section 13 of the Act: promissory note, bill of exchange, and check. Now, promissory note is governed by Section 4. Bill of exchange is governed by Section 5. And check is governed by Section 6. Basic feature of this negotiable instruments are: instrument to be freely transferable, transferability by delivery or by endorsement. In both ways, negotiable instrument can be transferred, but transferability is a basic feature of a negotiable instrument. Another feature is the person who receives the instrument in a good faith gets the good title over the instrument. Good title over the instrument means defect-free title over the instrument. Third is the holder of the instrument gets the right of transferability till the maturity. Now, once we transfer the instrument to another person, along with the transfer of an instrument, the right of transferability of an instrument is also gets transferred along with the instrument. Okay, this transferability right and the transfer of instrument is transferable simultaneously. Okay, they are not separate from each other. And this feature will be there along with the instrument till it gets matured. Moving ahead, now let's discuss our first negotiable instrument, that is promissory note, which is defined under Section 4. What is promissory note? A promissory note is an instrument in writing, not being a bank note or a currency note, containing an unconditional undertaking signed by the maker to pay a certain sum of money only to or to the order of a certain person or to the bearer of the instrument. Now, it is an unconditional undertaking, unconditional promise of making a payment. Certain examples of promissory note are: A signs instruments in the following terms. I promise to pay B or order rupees 500. This is the wordings of a promissory note. Now, I acknowledge myself to be indebted to B in rupees 1000 to be paid on demand for value received. Now, this is also a promissory note. Another example: Mr. B, I owe you rupees 1000. Not a promissory note because it is not properly drafted. I promise to pay B rupees 500 and all other sums which shall be due to him. Not properly drafted because there is uncertainty about the amount to be paid. I promise to pay B rupees 500 first, deducting thereout any money which he may owe me. Not a promissory note. Why? Because there is no clarity about the amount, uncertainty about the amount. I promise to pay B rupees 500 7 days after my marriage with C. Now, there is a condition. Promissory note needs to be unconditional undertaking. Last example is: I promise to pay B rupees 500 on D's death, provided D leaves me enough to pay that sum. Not a promissory note because there is a condition. Now, Section 5, Bills of Exchange. What is Bill of Exchange? A Bill of Exchange is an instrument in writing containing an unconditional order. In a promissory note, Section 4, it was unconditional undertaking. Here, it is unconditional order, signed by the maker directing a certain person to pay a certain sum of money only to or to the order of a certain person or to the bearer of the instrument. So section 5, bill of exchange is defined in section 5. Moving ahead, check. Section 6 defines check. A check is a bill of exchange, but there is a one difference, that is the bill. The check is drawn only to on the banker and not on any person. That is why it is known as a check. It also includes e-form of the check. That means nowadays when we go to deposit our check, there is one ATM kind of a machine at the bank. What that machine does, they click a picture of your check once you put your check on that in that machine. Okay. And that picture of the check gets transferred for the clearing systems. Okay. So that check is also governed by section 6 of a Negotiable Instrument Act. Moving ahead. Now let's distinguish about the promissory note and bill of exchange. A promissory note is a two-party instrument. In a promissory note, there are only two parties. One is the person who makes a promise and the person to whom a promise is made. Okay, that means one, the maker of the promissory note, and the one who is supposed to receive the payment. Okay, in a bill of exchange, there are three parties: drawer, drawee, and a payee. Drawer who draws the bill, drawee on whom the bill is drawn, and the payee who is supposed to receive the payment. So these are the parties to the bill of exchange. Though any two out of the three capacities may be filled by one and the same person. Okay, in a bill, the drawer is the maker who orders the drawee to pay the bill to the person called the payee or to his order. When the drawee accepts the bill, he is called the acceptor. Okay, so this was the first basic difference between promissory note and bill of exchange. Another difference is, a note cannot be made payable to the maker himself. That means one cannot promise a payment to himself. Okay. I cannot promise myself to pay myself only rupees 100. Okay. So there is compulsorily required two parties for a promissory note. In case of a bill of exchange, drawer and a payee may be the same person. That means if you have noticed that in certain situations, someone writes on a check yourself. That means a person draws a check to receive a payment for himself from a bank. Bank is a drawee. Okay, in this case, drawer and a payee are the same person, and a drawee is a bank. A note contains an unconditional promise, while bill of exchange contains unconditional order. Okay. Now, next one is, a note is presented for payment without any prior acceptance by the maker. A bill payable after sight must be accepted by the drawee or someone else on his behalf before it can be presented for a payment. Okay, so in promissory note, there is no requirement of a prior acceptance by the maker. But in case of a bill of exchange, acceptance is very important. Okay, if a bill is payable after sight, it must be accepted by the drawee or someone else who is authorized to accept that bill on behalf of the drawee. Okay, before it is presented for a payment. Thank you everyone. I hope you got a brief idea about the negotiable instruments and types of negotiable instruments. If you have any doubt in this, you may contact us at Bank Exams today. Thank you.